God bless you, and thank you so much for coming out today. It's always a pleasure to be with you, even by video. If you're watching this in a congregation in Tel Aviv or in Haifa, or maybe at a home fellowship. But God bless you. I know that you have other things that you could be doing today, but you chose to put the Word of God first, and you chose to put the things of the kingdom of heaven first. God's going to bless you for that. You know, every once in a while, I go away from the things that we've been teaching through, and I do a special topic. And I have a couple or three different types of special topics that I do because I feel like they're really important for the congregation, for the brothers and sisters to remember. They're important things to remember in your walk with the Lord, things that will help you not only in loving the Lord with all your heart and mind and strength, but with loving your neighbor as yourself. Because after all, other people are also created in the image of God. So how can we say that we love God if we can't love those that are made in His image? You may say, well, sometimes that's not very easy to do because some of those people that are made in His image don't act like they have anything to do with Him. And you're right. But the example that the Messiah had in Yeshua, Jesus the Christ, the example that we have in Him is even though the people did not appreciate Him, even though the world rejected Him, even though the Romans and the Jewish people and the Gentiles rose up all together against Him and didn't want to have anything to do with Him, even though all of that, He still loved them and He gave His life for them so that they could have everlasting life in heaven at the end of this life on earth. They didn't understand at that time what He was doing for them. But for those that finally believed on Him and understood, then it became easy to love Him because they saw how much He loved them first. They saw how much He served them in His love. And that's what I'd like to talk to you about today. We're going to take a break from our Genesis study for just this one week. And I'd like to talk to you about a very important subject. I'd like to talk to you about living your life upside down. Now, what do I mean by that? Walking around standing on your head and trying to walk on your hands? No. I'm talking about living your life the opposite of what the world expects you to do. I'm talking about living your life in the way God expects you to do it. I'd like to talk to you today about being a servant-hearted person, about what that means. If you would, open in your Bibles to Mark chapter 9 today. I'll read this to you. We're going to start at Mark chapter 9. Just go for a few verses, then we'll discuss this. Mark chapter 9, verse 30, we begin. And it says, "Then they departed from there, and they passed through the Galilee." That is, Yeshua, Jesus, and the disciples departed from where they were, and they passed through the Galilee. And He did not want anyone to know it, it says in verse 30. Continuing, it says, "For He taught His disciples and said to them, 'The Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of men, and they will kill Him. And after He is killed,'" here's the good news, "'He will rise the third day.' But they did not understand this saying, and they were afraid to ask Him. Then He came to Capernaum," Capernaum, as you would say in Hebrew, "and when He was in the house, He asked them, 'What is it that you were discussing? What is it that you were disputing along the way among yourselves on the road?'" Verse 34 says, "They kept silent, for on the road they had been disputing among themselves about who would be the greatest. And He sat down, and He called the 12, and He said to them, 'If anyone desires to be first, he shall be the last of all and a servant of all.'" Wow. Isn't that the way the opposite, the way the world works? I mean, the world teaches you that you should gain wealth. The world teaches you that you should gain power over other people and that you're really important when you have a lot of people serving you. And that's the way the world lifts you up and says, oh, he's important. She's special because look at all the people that they have serving them. Look at all the power they have. That's why dictators and people ruling these countries are so ruthless to keep power to themselves because the world sees them as powerful and special. But Yeshua came and he said, actually, it's just the opposite in the kingdom of God. Because even the Son of God who came to save the world from its sins and to give you everlasting life left his throne in glory and he became a servant even to the point of giving his life on the cross, the cruelest of deaths, in the crucifixion, so that you would be able to have everlasting life, so that your sins would be on him and he would take your punishment for you so that you could live forever in the presence of a perfect and holy and righteous God. You couldn't do that before when you had sins. But now that the Son of God has come and all who believe on him have their sins forgiven and he's taken away their guilt and their shame and their sin, there is no judgment of their sins because those sins have been put onto the Son of God who loved them and gave himself for them. That's why he's called in the book of Isaiah in chapter 53. In Hebrew, you would say, Basefer Bereshit, Slicha, Basefer Yeshayahu Hanavi, Veperek Chamishim Veshalosh, you would say that he had been called the servant there, the servant of God, right? Because that's what the scripture says. Why was he called the servant of God? Well, it says right there in chapter 53, because he gave his life as an atonement for the sins of many. And he poured out himself on the cross, even to the point of giving his life away. And because of that, God said he would see the end of his labors. He would see the fruit of his labors. In other words, he would not stay dead. He would be raised from the dead and he would see the things that God had accomplished through him. And he would be joyful in the end because of that. Oh, he's not dead. He is alive. That's what the Tanakh says in Isaiah chapter 53. That's what the book of Psalms says. That's what all of the Old Testament, the Tanakh, says. So as you look at the scriptures with an open understanding, with an open heart, and you pray and you ask God to give you an understanding to these things, God will reveal the servant heart of the servant of God, Jesus, the Messiah. So as you look at his life, you have an example of how God expects you to live your life. In fact, when you serve others, you're really humbling yourself. You may remember that throughout the scriptures, especially in the book of Proverbs, it warns us that God will resist the proud. He'll bring them low, but the humble, he will exalt. He loves it when you humble yourself. What does that mean? It means that you are not thinking of yourself as special. You're not thinking of yourself as high and mighty. You're not thinking of yourself as better than that person or more righteous than this person. A lot of people in the world today do that. A lot of religious people do that. They tend to look at others with disdain and they think, oh, that dirty sinner, I'm more righteous than him. Or you look over here and you say, why did that man win the lottery? I'm better than him. I should have won the lottery. And you tend to think of yourself as being someone high and mighty. But you're looking at yourself the way the world looks at you. You're looking at your power. You're looking at your accomplishments. You're looking at your authority, but God is looking at your sin. And all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's what the scripture says. Ki kulam chatayu vaisku me'acharei chvod Elohim. Everyone has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, is what that Hebrew said. So, if we have fallen short of the glory of God, and He sees the pathetic state of our life and the sins that we've committed, the ones that everyone knows about, the ones that only a few people know about, and even the ones that nobody knows about. God sees all of those sins, and we've been weighed in the balance, and we've been found to be deficient in our righteousness before the perfect and holy righteous God of the universe, the Creator of all things. He will not tolerate, He cannot tolerate sin in His presence. He's righteous and just. He must judge sin. So His plan was to send His Son to die for our sins, to take our sins upon Himself, and He willingly did that. That's the grace of God in the Lord Jesus, the Messiah. And once He did that, then God can look at you and I, and He could say, that person is welcome into My presence now. He has no sins. Not because he didn't live a life with sin in it, because he did, but because My Son has cleansed that man's, that woman's sins from them. He's taken their guilt away. He's taken their unrighteousness away. And now that person can come into My presence where there is life everlasting. He can be in heaven with Me forevermore. He doesn't have to go to hell, to that place prepared for the devil and his fallen angels. This person is saved. He can be with Me. That's the servant-hearted nature of the Messiah. That's why the Messiah was such a wonderful inspiration to so many people. And He was talked about throughout the Scriptures. And by the way, that's why the Messiah had to be God, because everyone else had sins of their own. Only God could become a man and live a life free of sin so that He would qualify to be an acceptable atonement, an acceptable substitution for the sins of all mankind, and that whoever believes on Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So as we see, God humbles the ones who are proud, but the ones who are humble, He lifts up. He likes that, because that's the example that He set for us in Yeshua, the Messiah, in the cross of Calvary. But you know, sometimes it's hard to serve some people, right? It's hard to serve some people because they're just not very lovable. Yeah, I mean, you look at them and they expect you to do all these things. And no matter how much you've done for them, for how long you've served them, if you don't do something for them continually and keep doing more and more, then all of a sudden, they don't like you anymore. And they're just hard to serve. They're hard to love. They don't love you in return. But if you think about it, that's what happened with the Lord. He came and gave His life for them, for all of us who would believe on Him. But we didn't know that at that time. We didn't love Him in return. In fact, we cast Him out. In fact, we didn't accept Him at all. Before we even knew Him, He came and died for our sins and showed His love for us. That's why the Scripture says we love Him because He first loved us. But before He came and did that, we didn't even know that we needed salvation. We didn't even know that our sins were carrying us to hell. But He came, He saw it, He knew the problem, He saw where we were headed, and He came and He gave His life for us. And when we see that, when we understand, then it becomes easier to love others who may not be very lovable, because we were in the same situation with our relationship to the Lord, and yet He loved us. So shouldn't we love others with the same love? And then when they see that they have been unlovable and that we've continued to be patient and kind with them and lovable in return, that when they've cursed us, we've blessed them. When they've said evil about us, we've said good about them. And when they've done this and hurt us and used us and persecuted us, we have prayed for them in return. When they understand this, that inspires them to love us and to want to be like us. And if we're living the example that our Lord Jesus lived, then we're inspiring other people to be like Him. And they, in return, will show love to still others. But you need to remember who you are. You need to remember why you're here. You need to remember what it is that God is asking you to do here. Be a servant-hearted individual. Show the love of God in Christ, just like Christ showed God's love to us. And so, humble yourself. Don't worry about what other people do to you, about what they're saying for you. God has told you what to do. Love others. They're made in His image. And even though they're wrong a lot of the time, remember, you've been wrong a lot of the time. Even though they're unlovable a lot of the time, remember, you've been unlovable quite a bit yourself. I've been unlovable myself. Remember God's grace and His patience for us. Then it becomes easier to love others. But if you don't take time to consider God's love for you, you're not going to be serving others. You're not going to be loving others. You're going to be judging others by the world's standard of, what have you done for me lately? Or, I will only love you if you love me in return. That's the way the world sees things. But God's kingdom, God's love is upside down from the world's version of love and serving. I should say the world is upside down because God's version of love and serving is the right way. The world's is wrong. So as we go through talking about serving, you need to consider that the Son of God gave everything for you. And He did this so that we would be His. So when you're serving other people, even though they may be difficult to serve, even though they may be difficult to love and they may not love you in return, you need to kind of look down the telescope of time and you need to see what their life might be after they come to the Lord. You may see that the hardest individuals, the meanest people, you may see that the people who have said the hardest and hurtful things to you, you will see them with a smile on their face and the glow of God in their life, and you will see them healed. And that hurt that had been making them so mean and hurtful to everybody will be gone, and God will make them into a new creature just like He did you. So be patient with them. Don't look at the face that you're facing right now when you talk with them. See them how they can be once the love of God is poured out in their life and they see what He's done for them. Many times I think the source of conflicts between people is because they don't know how to serve. Think about it. Power struggles throughout the world, wars that happen, dictators that stay in the power, ruthless dictators who kill tens of thousands of their own people just so that they can stay in power in the palace of the dictator and eat fancy food and do all of these things. Those are conflicts because that person thinks that he must be the one who is always being served. He's not thinking of himself as a servant of others. He's thinking of himself as someone that everybody else should serve. So he starts these conflicts. He hurts and imprisons and even kills those who disagree with him, who want to see him gone because he's mean and he's not loving and he's just in it for himself. And when people see that, they don't want to serve him. He's not a kind king. He's an evil king. He's a dictator, but a loving king, a loving ruler, will pour himself out and serve others. Think of it like this. Have you ever seen two people going through a door and one holds the door open for the other and he says, after you, please. And the other guy says, no, after you, please. And they stand there and they're arguing back and forth about who is going to be the servant. What if kings and rulers did that? What if everybody in the world did that? And they said, you know, look, you need to start doing this because people were hurt when you did what you did before. And the king says, well, you may be right. I'm going to think about that and I'll try to change in that respect. That never really happens, right? Usually the king tries to do what we say, save face. And he tries to insist that he's wrong. And he says, who are you to tell me what I'm doing? He says, I'm the king. Everything I've done is right. I haven't done anything wrong. Away with you. That king's not a servant. The world's version of serving, the world's version of a king, is upside down from what God's version is. God's king is loving. God's king is a servant to all. When you freely serve others, they're drawn to you. They want to be a subject of yours. They want to be with you. They want to be near you because they recognize that you love them and that you are caring for them. It's not about you anymore when you're serving others. Take you out of your mind. Put others and God into your mind, and I guarantee your life will be a whole lot happier than it is today. The things that you're looking for in the ways of the world, by getting other people to serve you, by having power, by having authority, all of those things are only going to make you sad. They're not going to make you happy. You think that they're going to make you happy, but actually it does the opposite. That's because your understanding, that's because your mind, that's because your reasoning is upside down from the way God wants you to be. When you reconcile yourself to God and you say, I'm going to love God, I'm going to love other people, even though some of them may not be lovable, I'm going to do this and I'm going to serve God, you're going to find that that frown on your face all the time turns into a smile. You know, you've heard that it said that a smile is just a frown turned upside down. Well, turn your attitude around, turn your life upside down in serving others, and your frown will also go with it and turn into a smile. You'll have true joy and happiness in life. Sometimes people have to force us to do things because we have to be persuaded because they know that we won't do it out of the goodness of our own heart because a lot of people are only thinking of themselves. I heard the story the other day about a man who called his son. He had an adult son, a full-grown son, and the day before Hanukkah, you know, which is, of course, the Jewish holiday, similar to Christmas of Christians. The day before Hanukkah, he called his son and he says, you and your sister need to know something that I'm about to tell you. Your mother and I are getting a divorce. I can't take it anymore. After 40 years, I'm sick of it all. I'm sick of her, I'm sick of this marriage. I don't want to even talk about it. We're getting a divorce. So call your sister and tell her. This was the day before Hanukkah. Well, the young man called his sister, who was also fully grown. He called her and told her, and she goes, no way. I'm not going to let that happen. They've been married 40 years. I'm going to get right up there, and I'm going to tell them that they can't do this. That everybody would be affected, their children, their grandchildren, everybody, they can't do this. You call him back and you tell him, don't do anything, I'm on my way. And you meet me there, okay? And her brother said, okay. So the brother called the father again, says, look, she said, don't do anything, we're on our way there and we're gonna talk this over, okay? So he just hung up. As he hung up, his wife entered the room and she says, who was that? And he goes, oh, hi, honey. He goes, that was just the kids. I've got some great news. They're coming to Hanukkah tomorrow with us, and they're paying their own way. Sometimes people have to force us to do the right things. People have to force us to do good, but you shouldn't be that way. God shouldn't have to force you to do good. You should want to do good. You should want to be a servant-hearted individual. Don't serve because you're being forced to serve. Serve because you want to serve, and your life and your attitude will turn upside down to the way it's supposed to be. We love the Messiah because He first loved us and gave His life for us. Serving does bring out the best in people. When you look at the people who have been served by others, you've made an impact in their life. You've made them see something that they haven't seen before. They've gone through life with the world teaching them how to live, and they didn't think anyone would really love if there wasn't something in it for them. Wait a minute. You mean you're serving me and you're not getting anything in return? You're not being paid to do this? You're not doing this because someone's forcing you to? It's not your job? You're just doing this because you love me? When they hear that, they say, wow, there is another way to live. And I like that way that I've seen in this person. I like the way that these people live. I would like to do that. I want my life to make a difference in the world. I want my life to be that close to God that I will stop just thinking of myself all the time, and I will start thinking about others. And I'll love others with God's love just like He loved me with His love. Just like He wants me to love those made in His image with His love. You can't do it on your own. You have to pray. God will give you the patience. God will give you the love in your heart. When you look at the evil words and the hurtful things that that person may say to you, it's hard to love them. But if you look past the face into the need of that heart, you see the hurt in that heart that's causing them to say those hurtful words, then it becomes easier. And the key, of course, is to remember that God loved you. Even though you were evil, even though you weren't seeking Him, even though you weren't living for Him, He loved you. And when you think about all the things, just kind of go through the list, through the years of all the things that you've done wrong and against God, and you understand how many things He's forgiven you for, then it becomes a lot easier to love other people. But you must look at your own life to realize how much God has loved you and forgiven you in order to be able to love others. When you understand how much God has forgiven you and loved you, then and only then will it become easier to love others who are hurting you. If the congregation, if the church, had this sort of attitude in everybody who goes there, they would be always trying to outdo each other in love. But many times, even in the church, you have conflicts. This person is talking about that person. This person over here doesn't like what that person has said or doesn't like what that person did to them. And so they'll talk about it to other people. When you're doing that, that's not what God wants you to do. You're living the way the world expects you to live. You need to turn off that part of your mind. You need to turn on the part of your mind that remembers God's love for you and start loving and forgiving other people. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 says that love does not keep a record of wrongs that have been done to somebody. If you're keeping a record of all the things that someone else has done wrong to you, how would you feel if God still kept a record of all the things that you've done wrong before God? When you love people with His love, you overlook those things that are being done to you. And people, when they see, finally recognize that you've been loving them all this time, even though they've been unlovable then they will love you with a great love in return. You have shown the love of God. You've demonstrated it. It's one thing to talk about it. It's another thing to show it. You need to pray that God would give you that grace. He'll give you the power through His Holy Spirit to where you can love others with the kind of love that He has loved you with. The greatest among you, Jesus said, will be a servant of all. Are you a servant of all? If the Son of God could humble Himself to being a servant, to serve others even to the point of giving His life for them, shouldn't you live your life and show God's love to others by serving? Especially your brothers and sisters in the Lord, but certainly the rest of the world too. Love others in the world, not the world, but love the people in the world that they also may see God's love. The first will be last. That's what Jesus said. But the last will be first. It's upside down from the way the world wants you to live. It's living upside down from the way the world wants you to live is actually living right side up. It's living the correct way. It's living the way God wants you to live. And you can see from what it's done in your own life, the fruit that it can produce in others, if you just shine His love and be a servant of all. God bless you. I'll see you next time.